Welcome. We pierce the silence again and come together and see what the Spirit has for us today, that we may go our way rejoicing, carefree, clueless of the world, and without any need to figure out the world or figure out our pathway, but merely content to practice the presence and be noticing and honest if there's something that seems to arise that blocks the presence from our awareness. And the simplicity of that, how life, truly guided life, is meant to be simple. It's actually meant to get simpler and simpler and simpler until you can take no thought for what you wear, what you eat, take no thought for where you go, until you find that glorious Holy Spirit autopilot in your mind that's always been there, that is always on Christ cruise control, and you know, all you've ever had to do is hit that button and in your mind and enjoy, smell the roses, savor the days, savor the moments. There was a time in the monastery where the Spirit came through with three words. I think of all of them, Lila always remembered those three words. Clueless, carefree, and cared for. Mm-hmm. And that's living a delightful life, where you see that you don't have to direct the river. You don't have to tell the wind which way to blow. You don't have to even figure out what you're going to do with your life on earth. You can just let it be shown, let it be given moment by moment, and take some deep breaths and say, wow, that's a lot easier than the way I was trying to do it before, putting so much effort into contriving and controlling and defending and preparing. In the parable of David, I seem to go through Cub Scouts and Boy Scouts, and our motto was be prepared. And so, you know, that could be helpful, but you really have to look at what is the preparation. We were always prepared, you know, with our hikes and always have water and carry some tools. It was all survival of the body, be prepared. But actually, if you really look at spiritually be prepared, it's be in touch, be in tune, stay connected, stay aligned, stay allowing, stay allowing, stay allowing with everything. In the Manual for Teachers of A Course in Miracles, Jesus has the stages that you'll go through. He also lists the characteristics of a teacher of God, and it starts with trust, and he tells you the stages you'll go through, but trust is the cornerstone, trust is the first attribute, first characteristic, and all the rest, he said, rest on trust. So trust is very important, trust in the Holy Spirit, but then if you go through all of the 10 characteristics, the last one, number 10, he says, perhaps the last one to come in into accomplishment or fruition is open-mindedness. That's where this is all heading. There's nothing greater than a tranquil, open mind. An open mind does not judge. It doesn't already think that it knows something. It simply stays completely open, completely present, and therefore that's, you might say, the most delightful state of mind that you could ever experience. And even when you're going through the other stages and you're developing those other characteristics, you have a great appreciation for open-mindedness. Because it's free. An open mind is free. An open mind doesn't have an agenda. An open mind doesn't have preset conditions. It's not already thinking it knows something. It's completely in the unknowing about the world, and it's made way for divine knowledge, for heaven, for pure spirit to be welcomed back into awareness, because it doesn't try to tell spirit what it already is. It's open to be shown, to have it revealed. And that's really what salvation is. Salvation is not knowing something about the world. It's coming with empty arms, with openness. I do not know the thing I am, what I'm doing, where I'm going, or how to look upon the world or upon myself. That's what salvation is. Where you've actually let go of all the definitions of time and space, and the definitions of yourself, and the definitions of God, and you come without a definition. That's what open-mindedness is. There's not the slightest attempt to define a meaning. That really always made me laugh when I would talk to or have a discussion with a theologian, for example. And oftentimes the theologian, the first thing that the theologian would ask me is, define God. And I would laugh at that because I would think, well, that's for sure undefinable. There has been never, ever been a definition for God. And even the Course, it's just a word in the Course, but it's like signs and symbols pointing towards an experience, but it's not going to come through concepts. And it's definitely not going to come through words. But the ego made words, so we can use those words in practicing, and that's what the Course is. It's a great tool for practicing using something that the ego made. Words are symbols of symbols twice removed from reality. Well, right away, if that's the definition of the words, then we don't have to try to find God in the words. There have been prophets and sages. Most of the time when any of us listen to a Rumi poem or a song of Rumi's prose sung, our hearts start to dance and tickle, because there's a presence behind those words. There was a presence behind Shakespeare's words. There's a presence behind, obviously, the words of A Course with all of its Shakespearean blank verse. And yet, our focus cannot be on the words themselves. When we try to cling to words or define ourselves by words or identify ourselves with certain words or certain theologies or certain ideologies, then we still are doing ourselves a disservice, and we're really doing a disservice to God, the undefinable, by clinging to something that God didn't even create. So heaven is like a wordless communication of total communion, and it's described in the Course as a song. And it's described in the pamphlet Song of Prayer, and it's also described in the Course as the forgotten song. So not only is it heaven a song, but it's forgotten. It's been pushed out of awareness. And so awakening may be described as remembering to laugh at the ego, but it's also remembering to sing, like the birds sing all day long. They're just so happy, they sing, and that song is like a song of remembering. even in the story of Siddhartha, you know, when Siddhartha finally feels he must leave the palace of comforts, the palace of conveniences, the palace of a future where he's supposed to be the future king and all of the concepts, what lures him out of the palace is a song. Again, it's the song. There's some kind of song that's drawing him to leave everything that he's familiar with, to go outside the palace walls and to seek for enlightenment. So that's something that I think during these days of silence, we could say is it's getting in touch with your heart song. That's a movie too, isn't it? The Penguin?
Happy Feet.
Happy Feet. Remember, he's got to find his heart song.
And it's not like everyone else's.
No, it's not like. It's a dance instead of a song. He doesn't have a melodious voice at all. So he's got to let his feet express his heart song. And that's a beautiful metaphor too, that you aren't even limited to the sounds. You can still express your heart song in many, many different ways, whether you can sing, have a great voice or not. So hopefully these days of silence have kind of set you on a direction where you've given yourself permission to move in a very lovely direction, not really knowing specifically how that direction will unfold. And that's beautiful too, because you don't need to know. I think that was the most fun I had was, it was like when I just had that moment where I said, Jesus, take my mind, my heart, take everything that I seem to know or have in this world, and I give it all to you because you are in charge and you know the best way to use all of that, but I will not claim any kind of identity or ownership with anything anymore. Ah, it was like the weights came off the shoulders immediately. And I think sometimes Christians call that like a conversion experience, where they give their life over to Jesus Christ, however they feel or experience that. There's kind of a weight that lifts off the shoulders, like, okay, I don't have to figure this out anymore, even though all my conditioning is said, plan for the future, be wise, be kind of be good in preparing for the future. This presence is saying, no, just trust me and I will unfold everything perfectly for you without effort, and that you can trust in. And so it takes a bit of time, it seems, to relax into that and allow for that to happen. But then the miracles start coming and they start showing you things are perfectly taken care of and you didn't do anything to make that happen. You just said yes somewhere in your heart. You just desired it and everything trickles, just like rain falling down. You know, you don't control the rain, you just... You're Fred Astaire, you sing in the rain. And that, and Gene Kelly, yeah, those two, they really gave us a good pathway to God, singing in the rain. So, there's nothing that really can be conveyed in words, but hopefully you're starting to feel this glimmer of an inspiration, like a lightness in your heart, like, oh yeah, I can do this, I got this. There's nothing really to be so concerned about. It's the Strawberry Fields Forever song. There's nothing to get huff about. Strawberry Fields Forever. There is nothing to get huff about, and that's quite delightful. And you start to begin to like let these old things, like productivity, most of us were driven by productivity. Even if there were expectations of pleasing our parents or pleasing siblings, pleasing our spouses, pleasing those around us. Sometimes people get into pet pleasing. They so pull away from humans that they simply get a pet in their house and they become a lifelong pet pleaser. They turn into a doorman, doorwoman, feed me, open the doors. We actually have a lot of that going on in Camus. We have a cat, Monty, that basically rules and everyone accommodates. But he has no expectations, so we keep him because he's present. He's always totally present. We need the teacher. You can't throw the teacher out of the house because he'll come right back in anyway. There's a rabbit door. He can't be excluded. We were over there, and I think Svava left the cat out. Was speaking. Was it Danish?
Icelandic.
She's speaking Icelandic to Monty, who he's good with all the languages. He knows all the languages, but he. He seemed really fired up when she let him out, and then we found out shortly after that he went out and he caught a bird, and he came in and he was going to eat the bird alive in the house. So he was very fired up anyway. And then we also heard the story of how Monty was in there, and a friend of ours, Charles, who's over in Europe now, had remarked that cat is really good for nothing. And it looked over at Monty and said, he's good for nothing. He can't even kill a thing. And then within 15 minutes, Monty had gone out and brought a bird into the house, probably chewed up, decapitated, and laid it as a gift. Almost like, look, watch what you say, who you're dealing with here. Everything is just an opportunity for undoing. To see, you know, they're very telepathic. You know, oh yeah, I'm good for nothing. Well, you can clean the bird up. But those are how the lessons come. You know, whenever we make an I know statement, we know something. Then the universe conspires to say, no, you actually don't. You don't know anything. And so don't even bother trying to tell the world what it should be, because you don't know, and you're never going to know. And little by little, it keeps reminding us over and over and over of that. So I think that undoes this idea of productivity, and it's also something we've talked about a lot. I know Kirsten, all of us have talked about this idea of responsibility. Because the ego will take the concept of responsibility and it will project it to the world. You know how I said, don't project the error to time. The ego will take a concept like responsibility and it will project it to the world. And there will always be guilt when you take an idea, a concept like responsibility and you project it. It doesn't matter whether it's parental responsibilities or spouse responsibilities or citizenship responsibilities or anything regards to being a human being, anything regards to a house, to a neighborhood, to a country, even to health of the body. Remember, the body is just a device that the Holy Spirit can use as a teaching device, but it's not who we are, and we're really not even to project health onto the body. Because it's a neutral device to the Holy Spirit, no different than a leaf, no different than a butterfly or a rock. It's everything to the Holy Spirit is completely neutral, and the only value and the only purpose anything has is the purpose which you give it. If nothing has any value, nothing has any inherent value except the purpose that you give it. That's lesson number two from A Course in Miracles workbook. I have given everything I see all the meaning it has for me. And the only way we can forgive, and the only way we can let the Holy Spirit's meaning be written on everything, is to withdraw the meanings, the egoic meanings that we have projected onto everything. And so That's why this is not really a course in learning. It's a course in unlearning. Because it's a course in erasing everything, every speck of meaning that was given to the world, and letting it become an empty slate. The first newsletter I ever put out was called Tabula Rasa, and some of you know Tabula Rasa is a blank slate. There's Jeffrey, he's peeking in. Is he coming or not? But the blank slate is very important because the Holy Spirit cannot really give you the forgiven world unless you are willing to give the Holy Spirit the blank slate. The Holy Spirit cannot write a new meaning on the world while an old meaning remains on the world, while the past is stuck to the world in terms of associations. Then the new, clean, fresh, pristine vision of Christ cannot appear, and the happy dream and the healed perception of the Holy Spirit cannot even appear while there's an old meaning given to it. So now you know why it takes trust, because you really are having to, except you become as little children, you shall not enter the kingdom of heaven, really means except you become as dependent as infants are onto their parents. That depended on the Holy Spirit for everything. You shall not enter the kingdom of heaven. That the Holy Spirit is the gateway. And the Holy Spirit isn't a specific path and form. There are many paths and form. So we're not even meant to judge the path. It's very humbling, too, when you start to realize that free will does not mean you can establish the curriculum. You can't establish the curriculum. The curriculum is already set, and that's forgiveness. And then he goes one more step. That's at the beginning of the book in the introduction. You know, only the time you take it is voluntary. And then that means the more you desire the holy instant, the more you draw the holy instant into your awareness. But he does say in the Manual for Teachers that not only can't you determine the curriculum, it's already preset, but you can't even decide the form of the curriculum. The curriculum is not yours to decide, and neither is the form. And so when people say, I'm going to do a composite thing, and I'm going to take a little bit of this, and a little bit of this, and a little bit of that, and build my own spirituality, like it's a Lego game or something, and you can just keep sticking a pin in here and building this. No, that's actually not how it works either, because the one that's deciding and trying to play the pick-and-choose game is the one that's caught in the trap, and the one that can't find the way out. So, what does Jesus say? He says, you cannot wake yourself. You cannot wake yourself. But you can allow yourself to be awakened. You see, the humbleness. Again, I will step back and let him lead the way. Not because it's good or right, but because it's the only way that will work. If the Holy Spirit is the only way, and we're not talking about a specific tradition or culture or even specific words, but we'll just use Holy Spirit for the moment, but Holy Spirit is the pathway, and that's why that inner guidance that you feel, which is highly individualized, is so important. You have to come into a resonance with that inner guidance, because that will set you free. That will take you back to true freedom. And there is no human aspect. Jesus says it may even be personally insulting to the ego to realize how little your contribution is to the truth. And he's talking about in terms of the human construct, the human mind. You know, that construct was made to defend against the truth of the Christ mind. So that's why there's so little the contribution there. And yet, to accept your part in mind, to accept the atonement in mind, is so essential that your part is absolutely essential, that the whole plan depends on that. It doesn't depend on the human construct, but it depends on the mind recognizing its wholeness, and the entire plan is anchored in that, that it will not succeed. In fact, Jesus says it a lot of different ways, but he says, as long as the slave remains to walk the earth, you will not be free. You must set all the captives free. Like our The Giver movie, you know, how in the end he took the little Gabriel, and he kept going and going and going to cross the boundary. And when he did, it was like a ripple of light. Mm-hmm. And he set all the captives free in the sense that he set their emotions loose on them. I think we could probably do a sequel. We're all right there at that point. Now we've all turned to living color, and there's plenty of emotions coming up at the silent retreat. And so we're at that point. We're actually living the sequel now. At the end, where that movie ends, is where we begin. Really being authentic with our feelings, not trying to hide them, not trying to protect them, not trying to distract away from them. Really welcoming them, whatever they are, saying, "Oh, this is part of my pathway to healing. I'm not going to push this anger away. I'm not going to push this resentment or this envy or this jealousy. I'm not going to push it away. I'm not going to say that's bad. Oh, course students shouldn't have envy or anger." Jesus never says you should not have anger. He just says anger is never justified. So he's actually saying welcome the emotions, allow the emotions, and when they come up, don't get into ego justifications of why you're justified and righteous in having the emotions, because the anger is never justified. You will never find a reason, a good reason, to be angry. In fact, anger could not even occur unless you believe that you were mistreated by something, not yourself. If you were mistreated by something outside of you, that's the condition for anger. And Jesus knows that there is nothing out there forcing that anger, so that's why he's saying, just don't justify it. That's when you pause and ask for help. That's when you pause and say, oh, I'm never upset for the reason I think, instead of going into a litany of reasons why you're justified in being angry. He's saying, don't do that. Pause and turn to the Holy Spirit. Turn to me and give me that anger. I will take that anger from you if you offer it willingly. But don't justify it. Don't start looking at your brothers and sisters or the world or the environment or something in time and space and start to justify it, because all you're doing is you're going to put yourself in a loop. And that loop is hell. And he doesn't want us to stay in that loop of hell. He wants us to wake up to the kingdom of heaven. So really, this is a very straightforward path, and we have already discussed here that it doesn't seem easy at all, but it is very direct. And he does say at one point, if you're not experiencing what this course is pointing you towards, perhaps you have not done what the course asks. So he's not just going to say, I leave it all up to you. He's saying, I offer you my instruction, I offer you my guidance, I offer you my help, and I implore you to join with me and share my mind, not share my body. All the stuff about taking the blood of Jesus, drink the blood, eat the host, those are symbols, and if they're used to do this in remembrance of me, then I'd say drink the grape juice and wine and eat the bread. If you're going to remember Christ when you're drinking that wine or having that grape juice and bread, that's good. If you think that this is a literal body, that this bread is the body of Jesus, Jesus has never wanted to share his body with us. Why would he want to? Because it's an illusion anyway. Why would Christ want to share illusions? It was just there for a flicker anyway, 2,000 years ago. You can't share a body. And his blood, he's not Dracula. You know, he's not interested really in sharing blood, even. He simply knew that for generations to come, people would be eating. I hate to make it so simple, but he knew that for centuries to come, people would be eating. And when they would sit down for however two or three meals a day, he was saying, do this in remembrance of me. Like when you're pausing during the day to relax, you stopped your job, stopped your work, you're enjoying a breakfast or a lunch break or a tea or a dinner, do this in remembrance of me. He wasn't trying to set a ritual of control. That the ones that drink the juice and eat the bread, eat the wafers, they go into heaven. And the ones that don't drink the juice and don't eat the wafers, no, they burn in hell. And he wasn't setting up a church that decided whether you could eat the wafers and drink the juice. Because that's the way the ego does its religion. It's like, here's my rules. You play by my rules. You get to eat the wafer. You get to drink the juice. And you get to be saved. If you don't, you know, it's like he sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good for goodness sake. Or no wafer and no juice. So that's pretty heavy. I mean, for those that were raised Catholic, that's a pretty big deal. Your salvation depended on regularly juice and wafers, you know. You better be doing that on a regular basis, because if you're not, you're going to burn in hell. And, you know, that was... And some people laugh at this, but
only
like...
the Catholics. And don't forget about confession.
And confession, yeah. That's
complex.
Yeah, it's very... Very interesting, but what we're saying is, don't let your life be run by rituals. If you do need structure, then let the Holy Spirit give you the structure, tell you when to begin and when to end, because the Holy Spirit will not keep you in rituals. The Holy Spirit would have you transcend rituals and become the living presence of Christ and be so in the moment, so spontaneous that you cease to remember what a ritual is. You cease to remember what to do. You lose not only your short-term memory, but you lose your long-term memory. And you receive the memory of God. And so that, in that sense, dementia is reinterpreted. Some of us have had people that have had dementia and Alzheimer's, and I've gone to nursing homes and visited some of the happiest, most wonderful, joyful people I've ever met in this life are the ones with dementia and Alzheimer's. And the most freaky people are the relatives of people with dementia and Alzheimer's, who come screaming, running out, tears streaming down, they don't know who I am. You know, that's the terror of the ego, of thinking that who you are as a role, as a person, as a body, is all important. And when you're forgotten, then that the love is gone. It's actually the opposite. When you forget about the people, the places, the things, and you go into the holy instant, that is the love. And it's the memories that have been set up by the ego, all these associations, tangled mess, really. You know, it's like Shakespeare said, all the world's a stage, and everyone must play their part. And he also said it was much ado about nothing. And that's what these past associations are. They aren't love. They're the cover over love. And as soon as we recognize that, we start to feel free. Like, wow, the love has always been there, and I've just covered it over by these associations that I pretended was love. And there's a lot of guilt around that, because you have to maintain association. When was the last time you visited your mother? When was the last time you visited your father, your grandmother, your grandfather? You know, it's like this guilt is tied into doing. And the ego set up the doing in the first place. The ego invented the bodies, the ego invented the world, And then the ego generated guilt, and it maintains its guilt by shoulds, ought-tos, have-tos. And you never can live up to its standards. You'll never be a good enough mother, a good enough father, a good enough brother, sister, a good enough human being, a good enough citizen of planet Earth. You know, there always will be falling short on the standard. Because why? Because the ego set up the standard to be like a false carrot that you could never attain. You could never reach that. You can never even take a bite out of that carrot because it's always out of reach. Ego always keeps pulling it higher and higher, standard. And even spiritual awakening, it will turn into that carrot. It will turn into another conquest. Workshops, seminars, retreats, you know, and some people have gone through, you know, starving the body, and the ascetics would harm the body at times, and there was all kinds of things meant to reach God by denying or torturing the body. And then there was a flip side of the Gnostics who basically said, because the body's not real, you can indulge in all of the pleasures of the world as much as you want because it's not real. And that didn't get them anywhere either. So basically, Buddha called it the middle way. Jesus calls it the miracle. The miracle is a state of mind that transcends the world. It transcends the thoughts of the world and takes us home. So this is like our Course in Miracles party. And it is a joyful party. And we are here to celebrate. And we are here to rejoice. And we are here to feel nurtured and supported and not see it as a dependency where we need something or someone in form, but to feel that nurturing and support inside, radiating from the light that is within us. And then we start to see the characters as reflecting that inner light, reflecting it to us. While we believe in bodies, these reflections of light are very helpful. While children believe in learning, mentors are important. While human beings believe in learning, role models serve their purpose. We should not dismiss role models and mentors because they symbolize something that we value very deeply. That's why we respect our mentors, our role models. It also actually, we can actually throw our resume out the window. Just recently, this week, I was contacted by a young woman who's had a horrendous life of being taken into sexual slave trading and a hitman and suicide attempt and a very short life, but a very intense, extreme life. And yet, she had this mystical experience that seemed that lasted 10 minutes, but it went on for 6 hours with Jesus. And suddenly, that whole story, that whole heavy, laden, guilty story just got lighter and lighter and lighter. And out of that mystical experience with Jesus came this awareness like, oh, that's it. I just want to live a life of service and devotion to Jesus, a reverent, devotional life of serving Jesus. And hallelujah, that the years before were rinsed by that deep experience. Jesus can rinse away seemingly years of torment and torture, bizarre things that had a lot of fear and everything. And yeah, so she just sent in her volunteer application, her devotional stay application today, and now it's attached with the video. And I did watch the video, and she was singing Mariah Carey's song at the end of it, you know, about miracles. You can't have miracles if you believe, you know, the song. It's so beautiful. I think it's a duet. But she was singing that song, first speaking it, and then the end of the video by just singing. And Haven had a great voice. I mean, if you're going to attempt a song, Mariah Carey song, I thought, oh, she's confident. He's recording a Mariah Carey song at the end of the video. So it was good, but, you know, that's the thing. It really comes down to the spark in your heart. It really comes down to acknowledging that spark and to answering the call. That is what takes you higher and higher. And the ego will try to prevent that with all the coulda, woulda, shouldas, and what about this issue, and you've had this issue for 25, 40 years or whatever. Don't think you can just walk right out of the cage, you know, so fast. But you can. You can walk right out of the cage as fast as you want. Because as I said before, you have the key. You hold the key to the lock. Mm-hmm. And you can let yourself out at any given instant. That's encouraging. That's of optimism that's not based on wishful thinking, but it's based on God. It's based on spirit. It's based on strength. You have the power to turn the key at any time you want. That's truth speaking. That's wisdom speaking. That's not wishful thinking, hopeful thinking. That's truth. And we're here to encourage and support that. Again, not to set up dependencies, not to set up more shoulds and not tos. You're actually allowing those shoulds and not tos to be washed away. When you feel strongly you're to take quiet time or to take a walk, you know, even with the tiniest little things, those are little promptings, little nudges in your heart that Jesus is practicing with your mind. Like, follow those little promptings, follow those little nudges, as tiny as they are. Of course, that's the way Jesus works. He's not going to try to give you something that's out of reach. He's going to give you what's completely within reach, and then build on the success of, oh, how did that feel? Didn't that feel good? Yes, it did. Okay. That's how miracles went in my life. I had to build confidence in it. We know that with even a teacher with a child, you have to win their confidence. You have to win their trust. You can't really be a successful teacher unless you win the trust of those that you're teaching. Really, and that's just a conversion for your own mind. It's not like there really are people to teach, but you're just allowing your own mind to be convinced, your own light to be strengthened, your own strength to emerge from your willingness to teach what you would learn, little by little, little increments at a time. And that's very doable. There's nothing daunting about little successes following upon little successes and little successes. It's a beautiful way to go back to God. It's a beautiful way to remember presence. So, I'm here to join with you, and I'll open it up to anything at all that you want to share, or anything that you feel is a question or curiosity, something you want a little more clarity on, or maybe you're on the grasping it, just almost grasping it, but you could use some examples or something to help turn the key. Click it through. Yeah. Diane.
Thank you. When I've never been in such an incredible experience being here. This monastery is love. And feeling the sense of community, I became aware just now, when this gathering started, of the extraordinary arrogance of my own ego. I'm humble in the presence of love. And I had thought, I so get it. I'm reading Go Deeper. Have to go way deeper. Because in deeper it says, when you understand the problem of constructs, that's what I was reading about. And I said, I'm a construct, everybody's a construct, and you're love and light itself. And then when that song came on, it felt like I was misreading everything, and I felt really tense and doubting, and man, oh my goodness. Love holds no grievances. And I love you. I'm sorry. Please forgive me. Thank you, this Ho'oponopono. And I mean that for any projections I have put out there. And my whole heart and soul yearns to let go of the things that I have done to myself. Because in doing it to myself, then I'm projecting it out. And I love you guys. Not one of you. You're all amazing. And I was so scared when I heard that song. And then I just had to listen and know that under the words is that I love that song, Sun Dancer, dance into the light. I give my whole being to open up my sight and dance into the crack between the worlds. And I surrender completely. My arrogance is so not okay. And I love you. I don't know what else to say, so perhaps that's enough right now.
Spirit shows you some pretty tough stuff. Because, boy, it didn't feel very good. I trust you. And I am worthy of trust you like just a baby. Like an avatar. You're such a baby. You're doing things you don't know well. I'm beginning to see Spirit's little messages in just absolutely everything. I'm here to serve. I'm here to serve, and it's okay, you know, if I'm a little slower on the uptake. Okay? Because the intellectual thing, oh my, the intellectual thing is seductive and it's something. The words, the continual associations, linking and linking, and the ego is terrified. And it's vicious. I let it go. Let it go. It's sticky. So it may take me longer.
Yeah. It's so good to just, you say, let go, because it's, I remember one time I was on an early trip, I think back in the, I don't know, maybe it was like the late 1990s, maybe in the, around the late 1990s, where I was taking a trip with, down to Florida with Kathy Thompson. She was later Kathy Thompson, Kathy Martin when I knew her, and at the time in Resta at Burnham. And we hopped in the car, we're driving down to Florida, and everybody had, okay, you check this, and somebody get the maps, and somebody this, and Resta was assigned, she's the one who received all these 260, 270 songs from the angels, so she was assigned music. So she went on the internet before we left, and she got a CD, and she said, I haven't listened to it, but it won a Grammy Award, and it was a Christian CD, and I was driving, and when she put that on, you know, it was like four guys, and they had great harmonies and everything, but the lyrics were, I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord, I'm a soldier. Well, I just burst into laughter, and I said, did you listen to this CD at all before? She said, it was a Grammy. Won a Grammy. And so Kathy and I, we just burst into laughter. We just played that. We cranked it up. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. But see, the old way was, the Lord needs you to save souls. The Lord needs you to save the lost. Had nothing to do with, like, your own mind. It was like going out and preach the gospel to the four corners of the world. I'm like, the world doesn't even have corners. It's a round world. Who are these people? Preach the gospel to the four corners of the world and convert and convince. And Kathy's father had gone as a missionary to Africa to convert the heathen. But you know what? With the Holy Spirit's help, the heathen converted him. He actually was there, and he said, though the heathen were actually adorable, it was the missionaries that drove him so crazy that he got out of the missionary work altogether. And he came there and would say that at the Peace House table, like, the heathen don't need converting. They don't. And so when you're saying, I want to serve, there, just by the prayer of your heart, saying, I want to serve, will start to stir up what will seem to be opportunities that will just start coming to you. Opportunities to help, opportunities to link in and join in and help out in all kinds of ways. That's what we've all gone through, is we just simply said yes to serve, but we had no clue in how that would look or the form that that would take, but we were willing to let it take whatever form it needed to take for us to heal. And so it's not like you have to be slotted into the Lord's team or all this kind of stuff. It's the opportunities will arise. And it's absolutely glorious just by you saying, I'm humble, I'm asking to be of service. That's the prayer of your heart. Then just stay open. Stay open as these opportunities show up. For us, it's been, I always like that part, miracles are a collaborative venture. I like that word, collaborative. I live on that. I even have a folder in my Yahoo inbox that's called collaborations. And I keep getting so many things now that are flooding at me, and I'm so happy I can just slip them into collaborations, because so many, making a Course in Miracles movie with a woman who's a Hollywood movie maker, and collaborations in terms of music, in terms of art, in terms of literature, movie making. There's so many things that come across my mind, and it's because I love collaborations. I love collaborations. I love collaborating with people. People call to me, they write me, I get messages in all kinds of different ways. I'm like a tech mystic, so now there's like all these 10, 12 channels open, and they come flooding in through Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all kinds of YouTube and on and on and on, emails, voicemails, on and on. And it's fun because I enjoy collaborating. I'm open to collaborations, and I'm on the lookout, and they come. And it's so rich, it's so enjoyable. It's like, how can we both, or how can we all come together in some way that we feel the joy so much that we lose track of time and space, that the days drift by, the hours drift by in joyful collaborations. Very much like singing in a choir, where you just get into the singing, the jamming, the joy, and then you lose track of time and space. So yeah, Diane, I think that's like the joy of my heart is just seeing you coming open to that point where that's the prayer of your heart, and then you just pay attention to what comes.
I've never been still this long in my whole entire life.
Where I just sat and then had to just work through things with Spirit. I was thinking about, okay, David goes to Beijing or wherever, and they're not exactly receptive. Okay, and you hold, Spirit holds that center with you and speaks through you from a place that is not, that is free and clear and loving. And I thought, okay, can you do that? The answer is no, not yet, because I still get thrown off center. I feel like I get isolated, then I'm okay. Like the monk that can be enlightened in the cave and then goes down to the metropolis, and then it's not so easy. It's a recognition that holding, listening to Holy Spirit and letting Jesus be the master. I am astounded at how much that egoic connection wants to take over. And no more words, but that holding center is important, And I got the chipmunks. There's like the school in another way of wanting so much for that to be inspired by the love and the beauty and the support that I have felt here. And there's a lot there. And it needs to go way, way, way deeper. And I'd like that to be the Chipmunk Monastery or Chipmunk Academy very much. I will be one of the chipmunks, for sure. Okay, a little oversized, but I'm sure that...
Yeah, there's a great part of the course which Jesus says you can join with anything in this universe, a sight, a sound, a memory, an object. I've had so many wonderful witnesses of that, and even when somebody tells you they dislike something or they're actually apologizing. I remember you mentioned Beijing. The first time I went to Beijing, they picked me up in the car, and they're taking me down to downtown Beijing, and then the people that had picked me up, they started apologizing just as we began driving. They were apologizing for the smog and the pollution. You know, they were just saying, "We're so sorry that our skies are so gray." And I said, "Oh, they're beautiful, beautiful gray skies. I'm loving your gray skies." And you see, the very thing when people start to point something out that they're apologizing for, as if they wish it could be better. I'm joining with gray skies. I enjoy gray skies, actually. And people say, "What, not pollution?" No, I actually join with pollution. I join with everything in my mind because it's all unified,
yeah,
in unified awareness. And what is projection but the attempt to get rid of something that you don't want? But if you become all inclusive in your wanting God or wanting peace, then you will have an experience that there's nothing outside, and therefore there's nothing to judge against. No, pollution, gray skies, this and this. People in different countries, they say, "Oh, we're sorry that this is so small," or "This is this way and this way," but all it is opportunities to join in it. When I first went to Argentina, I stayed. They talk about Jesus coming to a manger. I had three friends traveling with me. We were offered the garage, the top part of a garage. So it was, we weren't in there in the afternoons because it got to be probably 45 degrees centigrade, well over 100 degrees in the top of this thing, and the fumes, there were gasoline fumes, and it was like set for an explosion or something. It was summertime in Argentina, and we were put in at the top part of a garage, and there was cars and various like lawnmowers and things underneath, and I was having such a ball. I loved it. It was my first trip to Argentina, so I was loving all the people. I was loving the fumes. I was loving the heat and loving sweating. I remember we were in a taxi cab ride one day. I took like 40, 50 taxi rides around this massive city of over 15 million people. And one time I was no air conditioning in the taxi, but I'm thinking, here I am serving God in Argentina. I was so heavy. And the windows were rolled down because there's no air conditioning. And one of these big buses, you know, some of the buses have the exhaust that goes out of the top, and some of them have like the big side panel where the black soot. I was so happy this bus pulled up, and we were sitting there, and I was looking and smiling, looking out of the window, and the bus cranked it up, and boom! It was just black soot, and my teeth were showing. I was so happy to be in Argentina serving Jesus, doing like two consecutive weeks of like almost like a Course in Miracles revival. Every day I'd do one or two gatherings, two or three, and when the soot was coming in on the face, and I just was like, I was feeling the heat of the soot on my face, and I'm going, "God, I love this." Because it's the purpose that is where the joy comes. Or the time we went to Colombia and Kirsten wanted to have some lunch, and we went and got our lunch, and I said, "Let's go outside. It was a street corner, And
For pizza patty?
No, this was when we were just going to go sit out and
have some lunch. Oh, when I first arrived.
When you first arrived, yeah.
Yeah.
And I just was so happy to be in Colombia serving Jesus that I thought, isn't, to me it was like a picnic. And she was like, this wasn't Wanaka. This definitely, there was nothing green. And the decibel level in downtown, there was horns honking and all kinds of sounds and everything. And I'm having my meal on the street corner and just savoring and loving all of it because I was serving God. You know, it's it, and it's fun for me to go into a country, even a country like, yeah, Colombia, I don't speak the language. Argentina, I don't speak the language. The smiles, the hugs, the laughter, the ability to let the joy just rip through, the glee to rip through, that was what was exciting and joyful for me. And for me, it just was like in Argentina, it was nonstop. It just was day after day after day, gatherings after gatherings. The people were with me. Carrie said she wanted to go to Dances of Universal Peace. I said, that's great. Go. You don't have to stay with me. I'm having so much fun here. I'll do fine. And one time we were doing a gathering, the people were like saying, Carrie's way back there. They saw her in a hammock. I said, yeah, she's just resting. Just it was for her. She was seeing it as a time, a schedule, and we needed more time to be away. But it's really all a state of mind. It's just all a state of mind. And the things that the ego does is it tries to, it first judges, and then it projects what it is already judged against. Pollution is entirely neutral. There's nothing good or bad about pollution. But it's when you take that concept and you judge against it, you know, it's the opposite of clean, polluted, and then you project it out, and you find evidence, false evidence appearing real. You see, that's how it works. You first have to judge against something in your own mind for it to, for the anger, for the irritation and annoyance to occur. Then you see a witness for what you've already judged against. You've already decided, I don't like this. And then it appears on the screen.
Oh my God.
That's how it works. So it's very simple. The forgiveness has to be come back to the mind where you start to come deeper to that point of, I do not know. Who am I to judge? Who am I to judge anything? God didn't create me to be a judge. And when you get back to that, who am I to judge, it takes you back to that I am-ness, which is prior to judgment, prior to the world. That's where your strength is. That's where your invulnerability is back in that beingness, back in that I am-ness. And Jesus says, without judgment, all things are equally acceptable. Isn't that a beautiful line? Mm-hmm. Without judgment, all things are equally acceptable. That's what he taught us in the Sermon on the Mount. Judge not, lest you be judged. Yeah. If you judge with your mind, you experience the immediate effect of that judgment.
I did, and it wasn't okay at all. Thank you.
Yeah, that's it.
I did, yeah.
You don't have to do that anymore.
Oh, I'm so glad. Oh, my gosh.
Remember the song? I bought a ticket to the world, but now I've come back again. Why do I find it hard to write the next line? Oh, I want the truth to be said. You see, when you buy a ticket to the world, what do you think you're going to get? You know, God didn't create it. And Jesus has transcended it. So if you buy a ticket to the world, you know what you're in for. But now I've come back again. Where? Back to I am-ness. Why do I find it hard to write the next line? There isn't one. There isn't a next line. That's why it's hard to write the next line. Enough said. I am. Enough. Enough. Jesus says, we say God is, and we cease to speak. It's in the workbook. Isn't that beautiful? Two words. God is. Okay. Enough said.
Just forget about it.
Yeah. Just forget about it. Just forget about it.
Yeah, this has been a is it on?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This has been a great opportunity for me to really watch my mind and see everything that you just explained, how apparent it is that it's all projected, everything that I want to put out. Like, there's a few themes in my life that one of them has been that people don't like me. and that, you know, and in relationships with men, it's always been, there's always someone else. And, you know, I'm the one that gets passed over. And I found myself in this environment letting those themes come up, but immediately correcting them because now I know the truth, that there's nothing out there. So all of these projections just need to be healed in my mind, and then I walk free. And what a great environment to be able to really see that there isn't anything causative in the world. And it's just, it's a gift. And then, you know, I was playing on Facebook last night. I figured you guys were monitoring my Facebook, too. You did? Well, Suzanne, you're it. She was monitoring.
You know, Facebook.
But, she told me to go off my Facebook. See? Well, I was right. But anyways, no. That was valid guilt right there. there was a guy on there who was just ranting about, he lived in Sedona, and he was ranting about these spiritual people that appear to be spiritual and they're really not spiritual, and they're showing up everywhere. This rant went on for 10 or 11 paragraphs, and I thought, boy, this guy's really struggling with his own, you know, his own stuff. And then you start to really be aware that it's all our inner struggle. It really has nothing to do with anybody else. And I like what you shared about that. You explained really clearly that if we're angry, then we're going to find a place to place it. Mm-hmm. That it's within us, and we're going to project it out onto wherever we need to project it, so we don't have to do the deep work and let the anger and the darkness come up in us. That we can then have the healing. If I project it out on you, then I never have to do the work. Of course, I'll be miserable the rest of my life. So it's just coming together, and I really see that this is just a beautiful opportunity to let it all go, all concepts of who did what and where, and just go back to the truth, which is I'm innocent. And so is everyone else. And there is no one else. There's just the one mind. So it's been very good to practice here. Thanks.
Thank you, Rita. Your smile says it all.
Oh,
your
yeah.
smile says it all.
Yeah. I have a comment.
This is, I've never been in a retreat. I've been around community, but not quite in this, well, anyway, it doesn't really matter the form, but there's a lot of people here. I was really I really think I stayed pretty open-minded, though. It was great to travel here with Calico. That was a great way to kind of come in, you know, for both of us. Or I don't know Calico, but I won't speak for her. But the thing I wanted to comment that I thought was really fantastic, I've shared kind of small spaces with women before at another gathering or thing I was at, but wow, I was amazed with one bathroom with 20 women on the same floor. I had to wait maybe once or twice. I mean, the bathroom wasn't open, and there was such a beautiful flow of how everyone just there was a lot of cooperation with the lights, and I could feel myself wanting to manage the fan again. I have a switch right under my bonnet there so I can flip it on. Or my foot even out. And I think I'm going to kind of miss that, all the pitter-patter and the waking up and all the bag stuff, you know, zippers and sounds, getting your vitamins or getting your this or that and sorting things out and seeing feet hanging out, just feet from the bunks with the curtains closed. It was a really great environment to feel that oneness with these lovely folks. So thank you.
Beautiful. Yeah. Sign of retreat. You notice all the sounds.
So this is kind of going back to how your thoughts are really manifesting, right? So a couple of days ago, I was going for a walk, and I bent down to really look at a rock, and I noticed I had a sore back. So I came back, and I was kind of all tensed up, and was all in pain. And probably just before one of the evening sessions, thankfully I was reading Kirsten's book, where she talks a bit about pain, and then how, you know, that been projected forward. So then I thought, then I kind of, you know, well, where in my day did I do that? So I'd done Tai Chi in the morning, so I thought, oh, was I competitive in the Tai Chi, you know? And then I thought, well, had I projected pain on people that I'd seen here? But then finally it came to mind, in my life, I'm a physical therapist and I work with seniors, you know, and I'd had a thought probably about 2 minutes before my little back experience that about being with people in pain, you know, and immediate manifestation of it. It was unbelievable, actually. And then because once I recognized it, right, oh, you know, it's just the projection. That's all it is. You know, it's all it is. And so, yeah, by the next morning it released and I could go along my merry way. But it was the miracle was just being able to read those words that you'd written, you know, that kind of led me to kind of going back, because I was lucky because I came to the Course in Miracles through Gary, so I started practicing forgiveness immediately. And it was very... I was so encouraged to always keep on because it always brought me back to peace of mind, and that's what I wanted. I was after peace of mind. And I don't know, it just that whole thing, you know. And oh, I know, I was going to say that as I got really practicing that, I had to come closer and closer to exactly what it was that I'd misperceived. You know, yeah, I think initially, you know, Jesus kind of let me generalize, right? But then over time, I had to come back closer and closer and immediately identify it. And so then once that was identified, then, oh, okay, that's what it is. I released this and just done. So it was just lovely. It's just a beautiful experience of it.
David, I'm curious to know how you would how you would respond to this. I'm a chaplain, and I have these moments now and then at the hospital when it seems like I see people with hollow eyes, dead men walking, so to speak, so I'm clearly hearing that could be projection. But I'm also wondering, is it possible in spirit to see things, to see, you know, the same thing that I'm dealing with, others are dealing with, you know, the idea of separation?
Yeah, I think for me, when I had those kind of questions early on, because I'd worked in hospice and done a number of things, similar kind of things, or done counseling, and people would come in to see me and had similar kind of experiences and everything. I saw that there was no like specific way with those kind of specific perceptions. It came back to something much greater and much deeper. And what I came to see that greater, deeper thing was Jesus saying, He told me miracles cannot be performed indiscriminately. So I was like, okay, that's, what does that mean? what do you mean they cannot be performed indiscriminately? He said, well, since I accepted the atonement, I'm the one who inspires the miracles. And he said, I have to direct you in bestowing and extending these miracles. In other words, you need to become under my direction and my control to be a good miracle worker. You can't perform them indiscriminately. A lot of times, of course, in this world, we have jobs or we have things. We wear the role of a chaplain or a counselor or whatever, and next client, next person, you know, so on and so forth. And it can seem pretty structured and everything. He said, well, ultimately, that's why I'm freeing you and loosening your mind from a lot of the concepts and roles of the world, because you could be so much more helpful if you allow me to loosen your identity from these things, because I want to perform miracles through you, and I will direct you very specifically, what would you have me do, where would you have me go, what would you have me say, and to whom. He loves that prayer, when the mind's so open to being guided and directed. How did that play out for me early on was with jobs or even with my biological family, you know, sometimes you get so into the joy of the miracle that you just want to tell somebody. Mm-hmm. And I kept telling my mother over and over and over and over and over and over. And at one point I could tell Jesus was getting my attention when she said to me, I don't need a minister, I have a minister. And I was like, okay. And then, it came through a couple different other times from her. And I remember praying and going to Jesus. And again, he said, let me determine where you share your miracles. Mm. He said, they cannot be performed indiscriminately. Just because you have some past associations there and you think you know who needs to hear what or whatever, that's interfering. I will guide you where to go. So I suddenly saw, oh, that's the arrogance of the ego. It's like now it's taken even this miracle working stuff and it's got its own agenda, its own ideas. And he said, well, if you try to do it that way, indiscriminately, you will not consistently inspire joy. You're going to get reflections back of, I don't need a minister, you know, da da da. You know, you're going to get mixed messages back. And he said, it's not, nothing's going wrong except you're not joining with me and asking for my help. That's where the issue's coming in. So the more I was a counselor, I worked as a case manager, I did training and volunteering to train and work on a hospice ward. I did a number of different things, and all those things were just opportunities for me to practice the course workbook lesson. I will step back and let him lead the way. That's what all that was about. Not like these clients needed special healing. He always says, healer, heal thyself. Like doctor, you know, heal thyself. Healer, heal thyself. And so it was always about tuning in. And then I started to begin to relax into that, where I would just come together with someone, and I would feel all this joy in my heart, and then I could relax and let Jesus put the words in my mouth. If there was even anything to say, sometimes he would just have a beautiful gaze or a big hug or a big smile. Sometimes there was no words at all. And I would just enjoy what a beautiful encounter that was. And then again, another one and another one. So that's, I think, that's why it's a much broader thing than we think, because we like to think in terms of specifics, like how can I be the best chaplain I can be? And if I encounter people with hollow eyes, you know, is there something I can say or do? Is there a prayer? Is there a technique or something? But for me, it was always a much broader thing where Jesus was saying, just let me be in charge of your miracles. And it helped. It helped in so many ways, because I wasn't trying to force anything. I mean, I remember there was a time where back in the early edition of the course, I think it's changed now in the third edition and beyond, but it was on page 24, a prayer. Now it's on, I think, the later editions, it's on page 28, but it's that prayer, I am here to be truly helpful. I am here to represent him who sent me. I do not have to worry about what to say or what to do, for he who sent me will direct me. I am content to be wherever he wishes, knowing he goes there with me. And I will be healed as I let him teach me to heal. Well, that was such a good prayer, and it was like in italics, and it was right at the beginning of the book, that I said, gosh, that's good. And he said, well, good, now I want you to practice with that. Every time you walk through a doorway, any kind of a doorway, if you're going to the laundromat, to the grocery store, to a Course in Miracles meeting, to visit your grandmother, I don't care. He said, every time you pass your body through a door, you pause right there before you go through that doorway, and you silently pray that prayer to orient your mind into me. Because when you go to that grocery store, you're not going there to buy groceries, really. They'll get bought. But you know, he said, David, you go in there, you're reading ingredients and looking at lines and trying to go down aisles where there's not a lot of congestion, and then you get there, and then you've got 14 items, and you're like throwing them on the counter to get to the 12, you know, and all kinds of, you know, he was like, you've got major agendas going there in the grocery store, but pray the prayer, I'm here only to be truly helpful, and like, let me do the shopping through you, relax, look at people in the aisles, look at people when you get to the checkout line, join with them as I do it through you, you know, smile, you know. I spent much more time. When Jesus says the grocery shopping, it's going to be a long time. You know, I'm not going to get in and out of there. And the things with the right ingredients, he doesn't even look at the ingredients. He cares less about the ingredients because he doesn't believe in causation. You know, high cholesterol, low cholesterol, high polyunsaturated fats, low. You know, he could care less. Right, high fructose, sugar, no sugar, stevia, artificial, regular, organic, inorganic, you know, he doesn't care. Doesn't care at all. He's interested in the joy factor. He's interested in sharing love. He's going shopping to share a boatload full of joy and love. And it's like, so you see how that's turning everything like 360 of, you know, go to the laundromat, you're there to have holy encounters instead of the clothes still get washed and dried, the food still gets purchased, but the shift of focus is so strong. And really what I found was he was working with, I will direct you with your miracle capacity here. You're here to perform miracles. I will do it through you, but you need to keep turning to me. Don't think you know. Don't ever think you know. You know, and Jesus, if you go through all of his notes, because Helen took down lots of notes, he even talked about what we would consider famous people. For example, he always calls them by their last name, Casey. So he's going to talk about Casey now, Edgar Casey, famous psychic, and who did many treatments, many readings for many people for decades and everything. And it was quite an amazing career that Edgar Casey has. In fact, his son, Hewlin Casey, got a copy of the course, was given a copy of the course by Helen and Bill. And basically, Jesus said, Casey could have had a greater contribution, meaning contribution to the planetary awakening, if he had asked me which miracles he was to perform. And there, I said, there it is again. Now he's taken Edgar Casey's whole life. He said, he could have been better. It's good. Could have been better if he would have asked me which miracles to perform. Now, why ask Jesus which miracles to perform? Well, he's completed his part perfectly. So you talk about a bird's eye view. He's got a spirit's eye view. He knows, he's with the Holy Spirit. So he knows in every circumstance what the most helpful thing to do or not to do to say or not to say. He's in the perfect position to lead the atonement because he's completed his part. He's in touch with the Father. He's in touch with the Holy Spirit. He's really synonymous, we could say, with the Holy Spirit. You could just use those two words now synonymously, Jesus, Holy Spirit, even though they seem to be different aspects of the Trinity. They're actually synonymous, and that's, of course, that would make sense why to ask which miracles to perform. So to me, that's why it's so important to go so deep with this journey, because there's a lot of great teachers, Byron Katie, turn it around. They're just asking you to turn it around and take responsibility for your state of mind and not project it out onto people, places, things. There's many, many great teachers. And in the end, you want to just be of service and tune into that presence. You can call it Jesus. You could really call it anything that you feel comfortable calling it, but with that presence of love, and let love direct the way. Because it shortens time. It brings about more of a consistent experience of that peace and joy. So that's what I got when I was talking to Evelyn, my mother, and talking to different friends and everything, and I was getting mixed responses. I turned to Jesus and I said, "What's going on here? I'm so enthusiastic." He said, "Yes, you are. And you need to be under my direction if you want to have a consistent experience."
I've just noticed that having that experience, generally, I do hospital and hospice, but in the hospital, that experience is not bedside. Bedside, I'm more invested in my role. And as I've been continuing to do my own work and, you know, recognizing that my call or my alignment with God is more than my being called a chaplain, you know, getting in alignment with that, it's when I'm walking the halls that I have these experiences and I have an overwhelming sense of compassion and desire to connect. And one of the things sounds so simple, but just let your smile be the light of love.
Yeah.
In the halls.
Yeah.
You know, people see a chaplain around your neck, but who cares? You know, what are you sending out as you're walking the halls? And it's interesting because there's kind of a performa expectation when you're walking the wards. Oh, the chaplain's here, you know, to pray with me, read scripture, hold space for me. But it's been a different encounter when I'm just walking the floors. It's like I'm getting eyes to see and then, you know, kind of being directed or guided just to be salt and light, to be grace in their midst. Anyway, so I'm just trying to balance, you know, where is that potential projection, my own guilt, you know, and I'm seeing it in them instead of acknowledging it in myself, or where is it? There's a little crack here, you know, God's allowing me to see something you know, everybody's drank the Kool-Aid, so to speak, you know, and be light, so they know there's something other than that Kool-Aid.
Yeah, it has been helpful for me in recent years to just, as I got more into quantum physics, that, you know, that everything is consciousness, and that there's no subject and object, and no observer, different from the observed, and all that kind of stuff. The more I got into that, I just thought, wow, you know, that means
just be with it, right?
Yeah, my joy is the whole universe's joy, and to really go into that, just to get into that gleeful, joyful place. When I would have encounters coming, or have something, an intake, or a session, or to give a talk in a big conference or whatever, I just kind of close my eyes and go into that warm feeling, that glee, that joy, and it's like, ooh, yeah, ooh, wee, this is, oh, I like this, and then I pretty much forget about whatever, have to walk in front of 500 people or whatever. It didn't even feel, it felt like a quantum moment, like the whole cosmos was my mind, and the simplicity and the happiness of that, and then there's no complexity with that. You know, I wasn't interested in who was listening and who had the ears to hear and who didn't and all those things. It's, I'm going to have some glee here. Not interested in that. And the spirit's always appropriate, you know, in situations. If there's a smile or whatever, I tend to smile a lot. I have different hand gestures and movements. I was just out in Topanga Canyon, and they had all these different... They were like this, and JC Central, and this. And then they were giving me the things that I do. They were saying, this is the Hoffmeister. Yeah. I said, yeah. Really? They were even Kirsten was like, really?
I was like, what is that? Yeah. They said, it's a Hoffmeister move.
When I was a kid and when I was a teenager, I used to get so excited about things and my fingers would just go up in the air and I'd be
spirit fingers.
And then my dad would come in and go, whew. And I'd be like, because it's involuntary. I'm not. I was with the young hippies out there and they were telling me all my mannerisms and moves, and I don't know whether they watch videos or when they pick these up. They had four distinct kind of moves or something. Meisterisms. I said, what is this? Like, this is like cheerleading or something? You got
Meisterisms.
It's Meister. I'm unaware. I'm very unaware. But we have fun. There's glee, there's fun. And that's what we're getting into that. And miracles are involuntary. They should not be under conscious control. So we want to get into that state of mind that's joyful, happy. And then it's like St. Augustine said, love and do what you will. You know, the doing component should be under Christ's control. It shouldn't be that we think things and then we control the behavior as if we have to be appropriate and as if who's the one that's deciding what's appropriate. When we're in glee and joy, really, in the spirit, then it all comes out in the most glorious way. And so that's a practice. That's definitely a practice.
Yeah, what was coming to my mind too is it's either love or a call for love. And that's what I've always used for my own answer to that question. Am I in that glee? In which case, that love is just naturally going to show the way. Or am I really feeling, when I tune in, that I actually believe that there is a real problem and someone is in pain or is in suffering and I want to help or fix them, in which case it's a call for love, but that still doesn't give you the practical answer of what to do. Exactly. If I see that and witness that and I feel it, then all I know is it's my call for love in the moment. If I'm perceiving someone else in need of help, I'm in need of help, which just is a prompt to align my mind and turn to the spirit and ask so that I can come back into that experience of what would you have me do? What would you have me say, if anything? Yeah. And in that, if anything, there's the release from feeling the responsibility of I'm the savior.
Yeah. So is then by asking for that, that's the healing in your own person. Mm-hmm. And then if there's more to do, spirit guides.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Or not. It's just your own healing.
Yeah.
Is that what I hear?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a real giving over of the responsibility. Because sometimes there may be like an intense call for love, and your first response is perceiving suffering, feeling it because you still believe in it, but you just don't want to come from that place. You want to come from the healed healer, not the unhealed healer. Mm-hmm.
Goodness.
But it's giving yourself, but in that moment you may still be called to take some action, but you in that moment can't really truly be a clear channel. So it's giving your opportunity for the correction, accepting the correction, taking that moment to be with the spirit and then being guided. And the experience is so different. You're not personally feeling that responsibility, and therefore, you know, the witness could come back either, any which way.
Sure.
You're just with the spirit. And then you trust. You can really trust. That's when those sections in the manual come in, you know, has healing been accepted or should healing be repeated? Well, that's not your responsibility at all. You've done your part.
Yeah.
And then you're just there to offer what's given you to offer.
It's beautiful. There is a part in the workbook that says that the messenger must first receive the message for himself before the message is extended. And I always thought that, with these like couriers, you know, that have to, on motorcycles, whether it's pizza delivery or they're delivering a package or, you know, DHL or whatever, couriers have to, they have to receive the pizza or the package first. It'd be ridiculous to go out on your motorcycle, your moped, and you go there and you find the right address and it's like, oh, I forgot the pizza. You're, you know, you're delivering a package and you get there and they sign right here and you sign in the mail. And you don't have a package. So Jesus is like saying the same thing for us. We have to receive the message. We have to receive the message. We have to receive the miracle. We have to receive the gift first to extend it. And he goes on further to say that it is for the messenger. You know, so basically we're all like conduits and we're opening up to be channels and instruments. And we must first receive it for ourselves. We can't play this martyr game. We can't play this, sacrificial, I'll do this for you, and I'll sacrifice my time and my energy, and I'll do it. Because that's just a guilt game. You know, that's just got guilt all over it. So, to me, that was very, very important, because like Kirsten's saying, there are times when, you know, there will be an action component to say or do something, and there are times when it isn't. And you were quoting from that part in the manual for teachers, should healing be repeated? And basically it's like if you believe that healing needs to be repeated, then you need to go back to get your gift. Because you're looking out at symptoms or hollow eyes or whatever you're looking at, and you're judging something, and your perception is distorted. And he's like saying, come back. Come back to the drink of the well. Drink of me and you will never thirst again. Drink of me and you will never misperceive again. He's like saying, stay with me. And that's what is so great about the Course. For me, it's been a path of stay with me. Come back. Stay with me. Stay with me. It takes a lot of care and attention to move through a day and stay with the Lord when there's so many temptations to be pulled out into something, you know, in the world, when he's just saying, no, it's simple. Come, stay with me. Stay. That's like Groundhog Day. Stay. Stay.
I love that. I heard that so much in meditation. I would be sitting there cross-legged, and I'd have a vision of Jesus sitting right in front of me cross-legged. And then I would just, in my mind's eye, I'd see myself just go to leave. I'd be like, stay. Stay with me, stay with me. And for so many of us, you know, that's, it's not just a lifelong pattern, but it's so strong. We're so good at leaving. Yeah. We can leave.
We know where we're going to. We just
we walked out and walked out and walked out and walked out. And now Jesus has said, there's another doorway for you. Enough going out through that doorway out into the world. There's nothing out there. You've done that. There's another doorway, and I want you to keep coming back in through it and stay here with me. Dare to stay.
There's two.
Hi, David. My question is very similar to his, kind of. Since I'm a little girl, I've been always asking myself why I can hear or see God while other people can't. And I have been experiencing many manifestations directly through God. And many people said, like, oh, I know God through church, or I know God through somebody who introduced me to this or that. But nobody introduced me to nothing. And I wasn't even seeking for it. And it's something very strong that keeps searching me. And I feel weird, like my family don't believe me. And sometimes I'm afraid.
Yeah, it reminds me of something that Jesus said in the Bible to Thomas, because Thomas was known as Doubting Thomas. And he said, blessed are those who have seen and believed. Far greater blessed are those who have not seen and who have believed. So the Spirit we'll work with perception and we'll use aspects of perception that will work for you, that are, you might say, individually designed for you. And I will meet people along the way that have had astral projections, out-of-body experiences, manifestations, different people appear to them, like the movie Sixth Sense. You know, I see dead people. There are people that I see who see people that appear to them, apparitions, ghosts. And there are other people that would be scared out of their shoes if Mother Mary showed up at the bottom of their bed. They would just jump like 3-4 feet out of bed if they saw it. So basically, the spirit has a very individualized curriculum and will use the things that will work with you because of what you're willing to allow and accept in your mind. For some people, they have what is called near-death experiences. I call them near-life experiences because they go to the light. But some of people will have that or even a number of times, and that's their introduction into spirituality, is seeming the body, the heart stopping and brainwave stopping for a period of time. But basically, all of these things, if you look at more of a like a holographic universe or more from a quantum perspective, is that you will never be given more than you can handle, and the strain and the stress comes in with the comparison. When you begin to compare your experiences with somebody else's, or you start to have a lot of doubt thoughts reflected, like you're having some very, very profound experiences, and then the family members or people start showing up like, what are you on about? Like, what are you talking about? Like, speak English or speak to us in what we can understand. But the comparison aspect, Jesus says, comparison must be an ego device, for love makes none. And that's one of those things that really is a lot of practice when you start to say, I have to be comfortable enough with the pathway and the signs and symbols that are being presented to me. Also, the prayer of the heart can be like, please give me signs and symbols of that I'm not alone, or that I'm cared for, I'm watched over. And a lot of times those kind of symbols can appear. They don't have to be earthly symbols, but they can be more angelic kind of symbols and come in that way. I know I've given so many talks and I talk about such a wide range of experiences that people do tell me, oh, I'm glad you talked about that because I didn't want to share it with anybody else for fear of looking strange or being rejected or whatever. With near-death conferences, people have that experience where they go there and they go, oh my God, I was so glad to talk to a whole conference of people who have had near-death experiences because I can't share it with my family, I can't share it with my husband, my wife, and then I can talk to these people. There's a synergy that happens in 12-step groups when people go there and people are all working the steps and going through these experiences, and they feel so much like it's not their own unique individual problem, that just the synergy of the spirit using that group starts to wash away this idea like, oh, I'm the black sheep. I'm totally the black sheep and nobody else can relate to me, because they hear the same words coming out of all these different bodies. And they go, wow, I am not alone at all. I feel great. So the spirit can use those things where you're taken to a group of people or to meet somebody or whatever that are just symbols of I'm not alone in this. Because that's probably the hardest thing to go forward, where there's a feeling of like I'm all on my own and I'm totally isolated.
I don't feel alone. I think I feel like why they cannot feel or see the same things, because I pray for something and it's like it's done. It comes to me. And people ask me, how could you do it? I don't know. And anything, manifestations, anything. And I feel like kind of bad for them, like, I don't know.
Yeah, I think if you come back to that, it's your attitude that's the gift. And all of these things, signs and symbols, are just the symbols and manifestations of that attitude. Then it becomes simpler when you come back to that, that it's your attitude that's the gift. Because when people are talking like they don't have a connection with God, or they don't know the answers, or that they feel lost or whatever, those are just, again, opportunities to let the Spirit come through you in the most helpful way. So it's just a series of opportunities, one after the next, but the ego sits back and it's going, what is wrong with this picture? Like, why don't they do this, and can't they see this? You know, it's making it very personal. It's always trying to make it very personal, and in truth, these are very impersonal miracles. You know, they're just coming through and coming through.
I used to think I have superpowers. I used to think, like, it's me. But I remember doing something, and once I showed the person, I told somebody here, and once I showed the person my superpower, it disappeared. I never had it again. So God taught me, like, it's not you, it's not yours, it's given by me. So anytime that you perform something, it's through the Holy Spirit, it's not you, it's not your body.
Yeah, it's a beautiful lesson. I was out traveling one day, and my cell phone rang, and my friend Lisa, who's Lisa Fair, who's down in Mexico, she called me up on my cell phone, and she didn't even say hi or hello or anything like this. I answer the phone. It was one of those little flip phones. I flip it. I answer it. I go, hello. I want joy. That's what she says. Not hi. Is this David? Just think, hello. I want joy. I said, okay. I can join you in that. So then I said, then she realized in a couple of weeks I was going to be coming to where she lived, like really close to where she lived. And so she's like, oh my God, I can't believe it. You're coming to where, near to where I live in Harrison, Pennsylvania. She was excited. I said, great. I said, yeah, I'm doing a workshop at a Miracle Sangha place. It's kind of a Course in Miracles Buddhist combination thing, and this and this and this. I said, I can get there a day early. We can have dinner. I don't think so, buddy. Kind of like, you know, it's like, oh, she said she wanted joy. To me, it's like, I'm not thinking, like, go out on a date or something. Like, she said, I want joy. So, anyway, I said, okay, all right. I'll see you at the Sangha. But when I go there, I go to the Sangha, and I can tell it's her. She comes in, and she's got two girlfriends, and they're all wrapped up in blankets, and they're all shivering and happy and everything. And then finally, at the end, she comes around, and she wanted to hug me, but she was so happy. She was like a Mexican jumping. She was up and down like this. How do you hug somebody? Except I started to hop up and down too. That's the only way I could hug her. You can't hug somebody that's off the ground. So I did that, and then she invited me to her house, and I said, okay. And she's like, okay, what's your favorite meal? I said, what's your favorite meal? You cook me your favorite meal. And so she said, ooh, prime rib and mashed potatoes. It's gone on and on from there. But basically, when I went there the first time, I spent some time with her. She was so into manifesting. You talk about the secret, that's nothing. She was like, she was manifesting. She manifested her own business. She was the CEO of a company, manifesting, fixing up her house. She had a room of her house that she called the God Room. And every day she would be in meditation, and she would think of something, and she would go out in her day and she would manifest it. She loaded this room up with all kinds of things. Statues. It could have been in some over in the Vatican or something. It was just loaded with God and statues and all. It was called God Room. And she was so confident with this manifesting thing that her and her friend Bonnie, finally I sat down with them, and they were like, we got the power. You know, you've probably seen Bruce Almighty. I got the power. There were these two ladies. We got the power. And I said, what do you mean? We can manifest anything. Like, we are master manifestors, and we're in God power, and this and this. And the more I listened to them, they said, we believe we are chosen. We are the chosen. They were the chosen two women. That I said, to what? What are you chosen for? Well, God's given us the power. We've been chosen to bring the kingdom of heaven to earth. I said, no. I said, no, no, no. I said, don't you study the Course? Well, Lisa studied the Course. I said, don't you know the part about bring the illusions to the truth? You can't bring the truth into the illusion. But they had convinced themselves that they were so powerful, they would bring the kingdom of heaven onto earth. Those two, specifically. And so I was like, no, no. So then I was like, I took the air out of the balloon. As soon as I was with them longer and longer, then it was like, oh. You know, it wasn't the same, you know, going out and manifesting statues and everything like this. I said, no, no, there's a lot of forgiveness to do here. And you have to really clear the mind away. If you want the kingdom of heaven, you have to open up to it. You know, it's not, you're not bringing it down here onto earth. You know, we have to go the other way. And that's been beautiful, because then she did hear that she'd be a healer, and she has had lots of healing experiences. I think one time I wasn't there in Mexico, but a woman whose husband had studied the Course for some time basically committed suicide by leaping off of a tower where they lived, and the wife and the children showed up. I wasn't there. I was out somewhere else in Mexico at that time, or in Chapala. But basically, she welcomed them in, and the children came, and they sat on the floor, and the wife came, and the wife just was stricken with grief. And why did this happen? And he studied the Course, and it, you know. But it was so much healing power, and I saw that too when we were in China that time, where there was a woman that was just screaming and screaming, and Lisa just was able to look into her eyes, and all this energy and love and light and calming. She's basically destined to be a healer. She was in nursing, and that's what she had been, but the Spirit had always has higher calls for us, you know, to go into the depth of the height and the depth of our powers as miracle workers. But it's not personal. It's not personal in any way. So that's good. It's great that you can come and express that, because already it starts to loosen a little bit, like, oh, okay, I don't have to make a big deal about that.
I just have about 10 minutes, so this will be the last question.
I am really appreciating coming here, because I've been undoing a lot, and when I'm here in this atmosphere, I could feel the oneness that we are, that I felt even when I was in my home, that's not, you know, East Coast, but it's such a blessing for me to realize that I was feeling that even there. And when I come here and I still feel it, and then especially when I could feel the experience of the love, it's overwhelming and really great. And not me, I get to join in with the love that is. I like it a lot. And then I could feel it with Kirsten. We went on that walk yesterday. She's been so helpful explaining the little fuzzy things I wasn't quite understanding. But we were walking down the road, and my ankle felt a little stiff, and I thought with Jesus, I said, I don't even have an ankle, so how can an ankle hurt? And I trusted it. And then the ankle didn't hurt. And I just laughed with it. I laughed with the absurdity that I could even have an ankle. And it went right away. And then we're going on this walk, and Kirsten told me, always keep the presence, the presence, the presence, the holiness. And David was saying in front of you. Because I know I can't do anything. But I got distracted at one point. And I wasn't thinking in that feeling, that effervescent feeling. And I lost the presence, but I didn't know. I didn't notice that I went off. And then Kirsten turns around and looks at me, and I'm like, presence. And it's just fun to know that we are connected in that one mind and nowhere else. And yeah. It's good enough. That's forever.
That's it. Amen.
The last question. Yeah.
Okay, so here's a question. A lot of us have been touching on how family members react. They can, in my experience, they can be some of the most bizarre projections. I already have a minister or whatever. I was wondering if you wanted to address that a little bit.
Yeah, I think when we look at that, the ego made the world and the ego made the self-concept, so the ego projected out the world. And there's even a point where Jesus says in the text, everyone makes an ego for himself and for everyone else. So it's like a legion. You have an ego, then it projects out these bodies with egos. So we're never really meeting somebody in the present. It's just meeting a memory of them, meeting an unresolved speck of guilt. And my friend Resta channeled all these songs from the angels, and she would take down the lyrics, and she would come to me, and she would start to read the lyrics like poetry to me, and then she would sometimes, or she'd sing it, and then she'd burst into laughter at a particular line where she couldn't handle it anymore. She'd just roar laughing. But one of them was, I take my guilt in small doses. 6 billion bodies, give a little to each. You know, this is the angel, and she just burst. She couldn't stop laughing. She was singing it, and she burst into laughter at that one. So basically, what we see is these constellations, you know, there's a lot of healing, family constellations, and a lot of healing around that. These are part of the construct, and the mind, it's almost like Carolyn Mace talks about agreements and contracts before you even enter in. There's all these tangled web, you know, this tangled web of guilt and constructs. And when you're loosening from it, the ones that seem to act it out and have bizarre reactions or whatever are, I would always ask Jesus, like, what's that? What was that? And it's like acting another blessing, acting it out for you to look at what you still believe in your mind. Even if they seem to go schizo, or if it was a client I was working with that was looked like they'd gone into a demonic possession, and I'm like, what was that? You know, and I said to Jesus, what was that? You know, with this crazy thing in the eyes, and like Linda Blair kind of thing. It's like, what? And then Jesus is like, I'm showing you the shadows and dark spots of your own heart. That was his answer, you know. In other words, it's all opportunities that we should always have gratitude for whatever we're seeing, including it, the acting out of what we believe, because it's pushed out of awareness and we wouldn't be able to get in contact with it so easily. So we should have great gratitude. And also then, the more you get into your purpose, the more you're just, that's where, like I mentioned, let me guide you, Jesus says, of where to bestow your miracles. I, like most people, I had a biological family and some friends. I was pretty quiet, shy. So I had a small circle of friends. But Jesus is like, nah, come on, we're going miracle working. And then that's when a lot of the travels and meeting hundreds and thousands of people and on and on and on. It was like he was loosening things up to saying, if you can treat some loved ones with great love and devotion and reverence, I want to let's expand it to include everybody else in. Don't exclude them, but just let's cast the nets wider and wider and include everyone in. And he said, I'll do it for you. I'll show you how it's done. So that's the most practical thing. And also it's the best use of time. As a miracle worker, you'll be guided to where you can bestow your miracles. And then you gain more confidence. Instead of trying to work with certain ones where you have this thought, they are not getting it. They are definitely not getting it. And Jesus is like, I'm not asking you to make them get it. I'm asking you to love them and be a miracle worker and let me guide you. So you see how it turns it around from trying to work it out specifically to something much greater that's always there.
Great, thanks.
Okay. Karen's, I think we've come to...
Are we done?
Yeah. Oh, that's all right. But it's your call.
You have a comment or?
No, I don't know. It's not a comment.
Not a comment. It's a question. Oh, well, there's always.
Yeah, there's always tomorrow.
How are we doing on? It's 4 o'clock. Okay, it's 4 on the dot. All right. We'll keep with our schedule. So tonight there will be an experience, something to be announced on the board.